in regards to reading in the chapters that we break down, you know, when we're reading like six chapters at a time, now we just read, you know, like 29 and 30, really? That's nothing, right? Yeah. But, you know, there really is a lot to say here, especially when you see, you know, we're approaching the end of the book, so we're kind of coming to the conclusion of the matter. They're getting ready to go into the promise. They're getting ready to go into the land. They're getting ready to walk in their inheritance. They're getting ready to see the promise, to be everything they've heard about their whole life they're about to step into. And so you can imagine, you know, the expectation and the excitement and everything that's going on. So Moses is instructing the people, okay, things are going to be different when you get in there. And so he's instructing them on what's going to happen when they get in the place and what is going to be expected of them when they get in. Because he said, you know, when you go into the land, it's going to be different than what it is like out here in the wilderness. Remember, out here in the wilderness, we have the tabernacle in the midst of the camp, and then, you know, the pillar of fire and the cloud and the manna every day, and it's not going to be that way when you go into the land. You know, you may not see the tabernacle in the midst of the camp because, you know, it's going to be somewhere else. You might be somewhere in the land of Israel, you know? So you have to have faith to know that what God is bringing you into, even though it's different, it's following His Word and being established in what He's giving us. Okay? So what does the covenant look like? And those are some of the things we're going to address. All right? You ready? Nitzavim is the name of the portion, Nitzavim, and it starts off this way. You are standing today, who? All of you. You are standing today, all of you, where? Before the Lord your God. That is important, okay? I mean, if we say we're before the Lord, we think, I mean, let's face the facts. If we say we're before the Lord, I don't know about you guys, I'm thinking I'm on my face, you know? But he says you're standing before the Lord your God. That says a lot. How can you stand before the Lord? How could you stand before the King of everything, the one that made you, the one that created you? The one who is all everything, you know, all consuming. To stand before Him. Only one way. By His grace. By His mercy. And how He transforms you. Okay? See, there's a purpose why they're here today. There's a purpose for them being here. As you are standing today before the Lord your God. They're not standing in their own might. They're not standing in their own strength. They're not standing in their own thoughts, ways, or desires. They are standing before the Lord. And they're awaiting His instruction. Because they are getting ready to walk into the promise. Now that's exciting. If we look at that, we can see. So they are standing. The word is natsav. The word nitzavim, it's natsav. Natsav means to station or to be appointed or to stand upright. Or how about this? To be in the best state. Okay? By the best state does not mean your hometown. Okay? The best state means the best possible state that you can be in your existence is before the Lord. And that's where they're at. They are standing upright before the Lord with a purpose. And what was that purpose? Well, let's keep reading. Today you are standing in the presence of the Lord your God, all of you, your leaders, your officials, your men, your women, your children. Notice men, women, and children. And was it just all natural born Israel that was there too? No. Are you starting to see the wider picture? This is for all who would receive the covenant. This is for everyone who would desire to enter into it. Everyone, without exception. See? And I find it important to notice, you know, men, women, and children, and the foreigners who were not naturally born part of Israel. Because like today, we're like, okay, so we'll come in and it's important that, you know, the men and the women, they get the word, they get the instruction, they get all these things, and the kids can go off and just learn some Bible stories. That's a problem to me. And it's not that there's anything wrong with Bible stories, but we need to make sure that in the midst of the Bible stories, they're actually getting the Bible itself. Because it's not just about the stories, it's about what does the Word say. You know, the Word was given to everyone with no age gap. Everyone. And we think that the Word is so hard that a child cannot understand it. It's not. You know, when they first start teaching the children, you know the first book they start them in is Leviticus? The ones that barely gets touched in seminary. And when they start teaching a child, they start them in Leviticus. See? Amazing. Guys, the word is for all people, for all time. All who would enter into covenant. Okay? So he says, you are here today to enter into this covenant that the Lord your God is making with you to accept its obligations. See, verse 12, understand, you are standing this day before the Lord your God. The purpose and the point was that he causes you to be upright and gives you the terms of the covenant so that you as an individual amongst the nation of people that are called his can receive the covenant for yourself. And that's the way it is. We, as individuals, receive the covenant that God has extended to us, but if all of us as individuals stand together and receive that covenant, we become a people of God together. See? So although we are a people of God, we have an individual responsibility to it. Right? Verse 13. So that the Lord may now confirm you as his people and be your God, as he promised you and your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Verse 14. This is interesting as well. You are not the only ones with whom the Lord is making this covenant. So see, this gives the provision for all those who were not standing there that day to have access to this covenant. Those who were naturally born and those who were not. At whatever point in their life, they can come and receive of this covenant if they are willing, right? 29:15. But with him that stands here with us this day before the Lord our God, and also him that is not here with us this day. Now this is the word stand. It's amad. You know, a lot of times we say, you know, so you are standing. Amad is most often used over Nitzavim, okay? Amad means you are standing. It's also the same word for the prayers, the Amidah prayers, the standing prayers. And amad means to stand, or it means to continue to be established or to remain or to stay. So what God is saying is, you are standing here today in the best state that is possible because I set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. I set the covenant before you. You choose the covenant that I am establishing with you, and understand that it's not just for you that are here today that are being established, but for you who remain and to be established and those who continue in you. It's a continuation. It's not just for you, but it's all those who would continue in you after. See, now that means it's not just for you, it's perpetual. It's for all time. Right? So covenant was extended to all who were there and all who would come after them. Covenants are generational. Okay? Covenants continue from generation to generation. The following generations receive all the benefits of all the prior covenants that were established. There's an example. David and Jonathan had a covenant with each other. Because David and Jonathan had a covenant with each other, David sought out to bless Jonathan's family. Because the covenant wasn't just with him, it was with him and those that would follow after. God, even more so. The covenant that he established was for all those who he made covenant with and all those who would be established within that covenant and all those who would come after. In other words, Israel and all those joined with them accepted the provisions of this covenant that day. But not just for them, but for all those that would be descendants of them and would be joined with them. And you think, is that fair? How can someone before you accept an agreement before you were even here? And it be binding to you? See, this is what I'm saying. It's a part of being corporate. But yet you as an individual have to come to terms with the covenant as well. But it is being passed on, right? Here's one example. Israel received the covenant for all generations. It's like a tree. Each branch is part of the tree, right? And each branch is part of the tree. Each branch is part of the trunk. And that trunk is part of the, what's under the ground? The roots. So as the roots continue to grow with that trunk and the branches, the roots feed the trunk. The trunk feeds the branches. It feeds the leaves. And even though there are branches and leaves and everything that are not there today, they will be there. They're still part of that tree. It's not like the branch grows now that a branch grows. No, it's not part of that root system anymore. It's part of a completely different tree. It's not like that. Okay? Romans 11:18. You don't support the root supports you. Right? So, whether you are a natural born descendant of Israel or one that is grafted in among them, you're still part of the same tree, the same root system. Here's another example. Let's make it a little more modern and apply a little more, okay? America. Yeah, America. In Hebrew, I'm sorry, Patrick, I couldn't help it, bro. In Hebrew, the term for the United States of America is Arzot Habrit. Arzot Habrit. Arzot, the lands. Habrit, the covenant. The lands of the covenant. We call it United States of America. Okay? So that's what we're talking about. Arzot Habrit. The United States of America. Now, think about this for a second. Okay? We are a free people, yes? At least today we are, right? But look at this. As Americans, we have documents in place that keep us as the United States of America. Okay? We have documents that bind us together as Americans. Some of you may have been born Americans. Some of you may have come from another place to become a part of America. Right? We are united one country, but yet we are individual. We have laws in place that keep our freedom in place. If, let's face the facts, if laws were removed, we would no longer be free. We would have anarchy. There has to be boundaries for freedom, otherwise it truly is not freedom. Okay? Because you have to have something in place that protects you. All right? So we are born individually Americans, but it is up to us if we will accept, receive, and uphold the laws that keep us free. To keep us united as a people. It's similar in regards to what God has extended to us. He has His word that He gave us that is how we are to govern ourselves as a people free in Him. If we step outside of those things, we no longer dwell in His freedom. We now pursue our own way, which is really anarchy. Because we're not wanting to pursue order, what God has established for us to walk in. We're wanting to pursue our own desires. And let's face it, our own desires are quite selfish. And oftentimes, hurtful to those around us. But it's the Word that keeps us in that freedom that He has established for us. Okay? Deuteronomy 29:18. Beware lest there be among you a man or a woman, a clan or a tribe, whose heart is turning away that the Lord your God, and to go serve gods of those nations. Beware lest there be among you a root bearing poisonous and bitter fruit, one who, when he hears the words of the sworn covenant, he blesses himself in his heart, saying, I shall be safe, though I walk in the stubbornness of my heart. This will lead to the sweeping away of the moist and the dry alike. Now, we're talking about as people who will say, okay, this is what God has established, but what's wrong with that over there? I mean, I just want to go check it out for a little bit. What did God tell us to do? He said to destroy these things. Don't even follow after them. Even when those that I dispossess in front of you, don't go seeking after their ways, saying, gee, how did they serve their gods? Maybe I want to serve my God that way. He said, don't do that. So you are not to do so to the Lord your God. He said, listen to me and follow my ways. Okay? Which means we kind of have to get in His Word to find out what His ways are. Right? So, James 1:14. Each person is being tempted whenever he is being dragged off and enticed by the bait of, what does that say? Satan? Nope, his own desire. If it's not a desire, can it be a temptation? Think about that for a second. If it's not a desire, can it be a temptation? If you don't want it, at what point do you now want it? I know when we're told we can't have it, right? If you don't want it, it cannot be a temptation because you don't want it, right? And so he says, when you're being enticed by your own desire, it's like we say, oh no, the devil dangled a carrot out in front of me. No, you did. That's why he says resist the adversary. Well, how do you resist your adversary? Submit to God. Resist the adversary, and he will flee, right? Reading on. Then, having conceived, the desire gives birth to sin, and when sin is fully grown, it gives birth to death. It's our desires that allow sin to enter. Because it tempted me. How did it tempt you? You wanted it. You looked at it. You liked it. It looked good. You wanted it. And you followed it, whatever it is. But if there's no desire, there's no temptation. So when their desire for the things of God are greater than the things of the world that may tempt us, guess what? What can he throw at us that would stick? Nothing. Right? Hebrews 12:15. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God. Now that'll ruffle a few feathers, won't it? How can you fail to obtain the grace of God? I thought God's grace covered everything. God's grace doesn't cover willful rebellion. You can find that in the scripture. He says, see to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God. How? That a root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and by it, many become defiled. You ever notice bitter people are not happy being bitter by themselves? Yeah, bitter people, they're not happy being bitter. I know it's an oxymoron, right? They're not happy being bitter by themselves. They're not satisfied until someone else is bitter with them. You know? How can you be happy being bitter? But, you know, no, if I'm bitter, someone has to be upset with me. You know, if I'm miserable, someone else is going to be miserable too, you know? It doesn't make sense, but that's the way it is. Because when that bitterness is in there, it wants to grow and produce fruit and defile those around us. What would happen if we started to get like that and then those around us refused to be defiled? That root of bitterness, oh my gosh, can you believe what so-and-so did today? And you're like, you know, that's really the wrong attitude. Let's pray for that person instead. Boy, we'd just cut that off, wouldn't we? And pull it out by the root. So the result of bitterness is offenses. Bitterness and offenses, they go together. It leads to turning away from Yahweh, turning away from his people, walking away from the community, and resulting, as Scripture puts it, blessing oneself. Blessing ourselves, because we're walking away from the people, we're walking away from the community, walking away from all these things, we're blessing ourselves, right? The result we find in Deuteronomy 29:20, the Lord will not be willing to forgive him, but rather the anger of the Lord and his jealousy will smoke against that man, and the curses written in this book will settle on him, and the Lord will blot out his name from under heaven. 21, and the Lord will single him out from all the tribes of Israel for calamity in accordance with all the curses of this covenant written in the book of the law. Because we say, no, I can walk my way and God will bless me anyway because I'm his favorite. Right? We see that. We bless ourselves saying, I can do whatever I want and God has to bless me because, you know, his grace. God doesn't have to do anything for you. Okay? Malachi 2:2 says, If you will not hear and you will not lay it to heart, to do what? To give glory unto my name, says the Lord of hosts. I will even send a curse upon you and will curse your blessings. I have cursed them already because you don't lay it to heart. In other words, because your heart is not for what he wants. Your heart is for what you want and then calling it God. It's two different things, guys. We have to follow him and his ways for these blessings to follow. Okay? And I remind you one more time. Who is he talking to? He's talking to his people. He's not talking to his people versus the nations that don't follow him. This is to his people. Again, you have choices in everything. Okay? So what we find here is that Moses prophesies exile. He says, when you go into the land, you will not serve God. You will turn to idols. You will do these things. You will be exiled into all the land. And this something's going to happen. He says this. People will ask why Yahweh has treated the people so bad. You ever notice that's how we are? When we look around and we see all these things that are going on, it's got to be God's fault. I mean, you know, it's obvious that, you know, God wanted people miserable. So, you know, he was going to make them miserable, and there's nothing we can do about it. It's wrong. The fact is, you know, because of the sin in the garden, sin entered into the world. That's not what God did. That's what we did. Okay, it was our choice. Remember the whole tree? You know, God said, you can have of everything around you, anything you want, except that one thing. And we went, you mean this thing? It's the way it is. Right? So people will ask why Yahweh has treated the people bad, but there is an answer. They will realize it's not God was treating the people bad, it's that the people were being chastised because they turned their back on him. And that's what is going to be said. It says, they forsook the word of Yahweh, they walked contrary to God and his teachings, and then Moses warned that if they broke covenant, then they would receive desolation, exile, curses, and captivity. And that's exactly what happened. They broke covenant, they turned their back on God, then they were exiled. And then when they were exiled, they were sent where? All over the world. Remember the northern kingdom, the southern kingdom? The northern kingdom had the 10 tribes, the southern kingdom had the 2 tribes, and then the Levites were scattered throughout, right? The northern kingdom, because of idolatry, was scattered into all the world. And they become assimilated into all the world, even to this day. All right? Now look, Deuteronomy 29:28. And the Lord rooted them out of their land and in anger and in wrath and in great indignation and cast them into another land as it is this day. And even as it says in the scripture, even as it is this day, even as it is this day. Okay? But I want to show you something really interesting where it says, and he cast them into another land. It's not just like he cast like a fishing rod. He cast them. No, he cast them. Okay? In the Hebrew, this word is vayishlechem. Vayishlechem. I'm going to show you something here. And you're only going to find in the Torah scrolls. You're not going to find it in an English translation, or you're not going to find it in another translation. You may not even find it in some Hebrew translations. You're going to find it in a Torah scroll. Okay? Because the uniformity from scroll to scroll to scroll to scroll has been upheld for the beginning. Okay? They were very meticulous in their rules and the guidelines and how they copied a scroll letter by letter by letter by letter. And it was checked frequently and often, and there was a lot of regulations surrounding copying a scroll, okay? To maintain the integrity of every single letter. Not even just what the letter was, but even how it was written. Okay? I'm going to show you something that you're only going to find in those, okay? If you look in the Torah scroll, this is a picture from our Torah scroll. If you look in the Torah scroll, you're going to find something very interesting. What stands out to you guys? This letter right here is a lamed, and you'll notice that it's what? It's large. It's a lamed, and it's large. It's the text of the lamed is larger than any other one. So what does a lamed represent? Well, let me show you. First, the word is shalach. That's where we get, and he cast them into. It's to throw out or to drive away, okay? To hurl, to throw. This is how it's written in the Paleo-Hebrew. In the Paleo-Hebrew, we would have the shin, lamed, kaf. It's to push, and then the shepherd's staff, and then the palm of a hand. So to push with the rod in the hand, to drive away, to cast out, to push off. Okay? But there's something you're going to learn here. The lamed is a shepherd's staff. Okay, much like the staff of Moses, he was a shepherd, right? When he led Israel out, it was like, you know, that was God's flock, right? He led them out. So this is what we're looking at for the lamed. Now, the lamed is made bold and is made large to remind us that the great shepherd will be the one to gather us back in from no matter where he has scattered us. Even though the word is Vayishlechem and he scattered, it's to remind us that though we were scattered to the corners of the earth, the great shepherd from no matter where we are will gather us back. Does that sound like somebody you know? Deuteronomy 4. 27, and the Lord shall scatter you among the nations, and you shall be left few in number among the heathen, whether the Lord shall lead you. And there you shall serve gods, the work of men's hands, wood, stone, which neither see nor hear, nor eat nor smell. But if from there you do what? Seek the Lord your God, you shall find him, if you seek him with what? All your heart and all your soul. Verse 30. So when you are in tribulation, when you are in tribulation, and all these things are come upon you, even in the latter days, if you turn to the Lord your God, and you shall be obedient to his voice, he's saying, though he scatters us, though in the latter days, in the time of tribulation, if we return to him and we listen to his voice, there is repentance there, and he will gather us back. You know, the scattering and regathering of Israel is the most common thread of all prophecy throughout the entire scripture. It's amazing when you really start to see how it all comes together. Nehemiah 1:8. So remember, I beseech thee, the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you transgress, I will scatter you where? Among the nations. But if you turn to me, okay, so if you repent, what does repentance look like? If you turn to me, what does he say? Keep my commandments and do them. Though there you were cast out to the uttermost part of the heaven, yet I will gather them from there, and I will bring them to the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Though they were scattered throughout all the earth, he will regather them to the place that he has placed his name. Ezekiel 34:12. As a shepherd seeks out his flock in the day that he is among his sheep that are what? Scattered. I will seek out my sheep and will deliver them out of all the places where they have been scattered in the cloudy and dark day. And I will bring them out from the people and gather them from the countries and will bring them to their own land and feed them upon the mountains of Israel by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country. Though you were scattered into all the world, scattered into all the other nations and lands, you will be regathered and brought back. Jeremiah 50:6. My people have been, what? Lost sheep. Their shepherds have caused them to go astray. They have turned away on the mountains, and they have gone from mountain to hill, and they have forgotten their resting place. Matthew 15:24. Answer said, I am not sent but unto who? The lost sheep of the house of Israel. Matthew 10:6. He's talking and he says, Yeshua, he says, go rather to who? The lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I find something interesting where he says in Jeremiah, he says, the shepherds have caused the people to go astray. How have the shepherds caused the people to go astray? They took them from mountain to hill. This is my thought. I'll just kind of share this with you. Mountain in the scripture, what mountain were the shepherds supposed to keep the people at? If it's not Gerizim and Ebal, where? Sinai, Horeb. To keep the covenant before the people was the job of the shepherds. And if they were not keeping them before the mountain where the word was given, then they take them to the hills. What happened on the hills? That's where all the idols were worshipped. And so the shepherds were not causing the people to keep at the mountain looking to the Lord their God and his word and his spirit. They were taking them to the hills where they could all do what was right in their own eyes. Deuteronomy 29:29. The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. Really interesting when you look at this. First off, to understand the secret things belong to the Lord our God. Guys, I think we can understand there's so much we don't know. Okay? So to us, they're secret things, okay? But is secret, does it mean, because they're secret, mean they don't exist? No. The word secret is the word sitar. Sitar, okay? Sitar means it's hidden. It's covered. It's concealed. It doesn't mean it's not there. It just means you don't see it. Okay? Yeah, this is where we get the word Esther. Okay, it's the same word. Remember, her identity was concealed, right? And so, though there are things that are concealed or hidden, it's not that God is hiding things from you. It's that they're hidden, waiting for the right time for them to be revealed. Okay? Proverbs 25:2. It is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out a matter. He reads this way, the Hebrew. It is the kavod, the glory of God to satar something. But it is the honor, kavod, of kings, melech. Melech could mean king, it could be messenger, it could be prophet. Okay? It's someone that is appointed, someone that is sent. It is a melech to search out davar, things, words, things that have been established. And yeah, that's the same word for devarim, what we call the book of Deuteronomy. So there are things that God has concealed, but he reveals in his glory when we search out the things he has hidden. Let me ask you a question. You ever read the scripture and see something that you didn't see before? I hope so. It's not that it wasn't there before. You just didn't see it. And that's the way it should be. It's continually growing. It's alive to us. And there are things that we may not see today that we might see tomorrow. There are things that we see now we didn't see 5 years ago. And it's supposed to be that way. Right? Why? The secret things belong to the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong to who? Us. The word for reveal is galah. And it means, you're going to like this, to reveal, to be open, to be uncovered, removed, or exiled. Now think about that for a minute. The exiles have been hidden. Those that were dispatched into all the world, into all the nations, have been hidden and concealed. But there is a time that those who were exiled will be revealed, and when they are revealed, they will be drawn back. You see that? So the things that are revealed, that have been exiled, but are being revealed and uncovered, belong to us and our children forever, so that we may, what's that word? That we may do all the words of this Torah. Though it's something, though we didn't see it before, we see it now. And guys, the word has been hidden for a long time, and it's been in plain view. I mean, how many people are just now coming to the realization, oh, you mean there was more to my Bible before the book of Matthew? Like I said, it's the uninspired page of the Bible, the page that divides, you know. It's one book. Okay? Deuteronomy 30. So when the time arrives that all these things have come upon you, both the blessing and the curse, which I presented to you, and you are there among the nations. So you're there among the nations. God has blessed you, but you're going to see blessing and you're going to see cursing. You're going to see people that God has blessed you, but you're going to see people that have turned their back. You're going to see both of these things. And you are there among the nations to which Adonai your God has driven you. Then at last, I like that, at last, finally, you will start thinking about what has happened to you. For what purpose? For what end? 2, verse 2. And you will return. That's shuv. That's where we get the word teshuvah, repentance. Shuv means to go back home. Though you're off and you see the blessings and the cursings and you see all these things that have happened, you will return to the Lord your God. What does it mean to return to the Lord your God? What does it say next? And pay attention to what he has said. I find it very disturbing today, and I'm just being honest with you guys. There's no one in particular I'm thinking about, okay, guys? I'm just telling you, I find it extremely disturbing today that people can say, I repent, I turn away from my wicked ways, my selfishness, my idolatry, all of these things. I surrender myself to the Lord completely and wholeheartedly, but refuse to listen to what he said. Reminds me in Luke chapter 6 when Yeshua said, "Why do you call me Lord if you don't do what I say?" You know, we have a people who want that sense of entitlement. You know, I'm entitled to salvation. No, we're not. But if you repent, he will freely give it. But that repent means you forsake the sin and go to him. Okay? So you will return and pay attention to what he has said, which will be, what does he say next? Which will be exactly, not kind of like, or not completely different than, will be exactly what I am telling you today. So he says, so when you've gone and gone away from the Lord your God and you repent and you come back and you listen to what he said, which by the way is what I'm telling you today. So now go through all the prophets. What were they telling Israel to do? To repent and return. Return to what? To God and his word. When John the Baptist came along, what did he tell people to do? Repent and return to what? To the word that had been established among them and to the Lord their God who gave them the word. It's been the same message all this time, guys. Even Yeshua came to restore you to the Father, right? So you and your children with all your heart and with all your being. Verse 3, at that point, Adonai your God will what? Reverse your exile. What does it mean to reverse your exile? If you're not exiled anymore, now what's going to happen? You're gathered. You're brought back. Now it makes me think of when Yeshua said, if you're not gathering with me, you are scattering. It was one or the other. There was no middle ground. It was, if you're not gathering, then you're scattering. There was no apathy there. You had to be actively gathering. If you weren't actively gathering, then you were scattering. So I will reverse your exile and show you mercy. And he will return and gather you from all the peoples to which Adonai your God has scattered you. Wow. Look at this. One point. At that point, Adonai your God will reverse your exile, show you mercy. What does this say? He will return and gather you. Think about that prophetically, guys. Verse 4. So if one of yours was scattered to the far end of the sky, Adonai your God will gather you even from there and will there go to get you. The idea of even like all the way where you see the horizon and the sky meet, the implication is that's where you are. Even if you were all the way to the ends of the earth, it's still not too far for God to come get you. And he will come and get you. Right? Jeremiah 33, verse 23. So the Lord said to me, have you noticed how people are saying that I have rejected Israel and Judah? Have you heard people say that? Oh, the Jews had their chance, they blew it. Have you heard it? It's wrong. But yet, this is what the scripture says. This is what Jeremiah was saying. Have you heard how people are saying that God has rejected Israel and Judah? And notice the difference. Notice it's two different things. Israel and Judah. That's the northern and the southern kingdom. Okay. The two families that I chose, who together form one, but let's face it, they weren't one, they were two, right? They were separated. We read Ezekiel saying that they shall become one. We're not there yet. We're getting there. We're not there yet. And so they look with contempt on my people and no longer consider them a nation. But I, the Lord, have a covenant with day and night, and I have made my laws that control earth and sky, or heaven and earth. Just as surely as I have done this, so I will maintain my covenant with Jacob's descendants and with my servant David. And I will choose one of David's descendants to rule over the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And I will be merciful to my people and make them prosperous again. Who is that descendant that would come? It's the Messiah, right? That's your Savior, okay? Back to Deuteronomy 30. Verses 11 through 13, which, by the way, is quoted in Romans 10. Okay? Just for the... No, Paul never quoted Torah. Well, here's one. Okay? Romans 10, he says, this is the commandment which I command you this day. It is not hidden from you. See, we were just talking about the things that were hidden, right? It's making a very clear point. The commandment that I'm telling you today is not hidden. See, so it's not hidden where you say, oh, I didn't know. You did know. The thing is, are you going to walk away from it or not? See, you do know. It's not hidden from you. So that, why? Well, it's not far off. It's not up in the heaven that you should say, who can go to heaven and bring it down to us so we may hear it and do it? Neither is beyond the sea. You should say, who will go over the sea for us to bring it to us that we may hear it and do it? And oh, it's too lofty. It's too high. It's too low. I don't understand it. I can't do it. I can't do it. No, he's like, no. He's removing all of your excuses. He's saying very simple, if you just listen to the Lord your God, walk in his ways, follow him. Okay? That's all he's really saying. He's not asking you for something so high and lofty that you can't obtain. He's not asking for something that is so far beneath you, you couldn't possibly. He's saying all you have to do is listen to his voice and walk with him. Psalm 37:4. Delight yourself in who? In the Lord. And he will give you the desires of your heart. The desires of your heart should line up with his heart. Because what was the first part of that? It's not just, oh, God will give you the desires of your heart. Boy, that'll be a mess, wouldn't it? See, the prerequisite is that first part. Delight yourself in the Lord. Because as you delight yourself in the Lord, you're delighting yourself in his ways, in his word, in his life. And then since you're delighting yourself in the things that he likes and he enjoys, then the things that delight you are the things that he delights in. And so if you are delighting in what he is taking joy in, then obviously he will give you the desires of your heart. Because you want what he wants. Right? Proverbs 16, commit your works to the Lord and your thoughts shall be established. We got to get that backwards. Oh, if I could just get my thoughts in line, then, you know, I'll give myself to the Lord. No, commit your works to the Lord. Your thoughts will be established. Very simple. Do what he says and he will show you the right way, the right path, and you'll get your thoughts in order. How do you get your thoughts in order if you don't know what you're lining them up with? Take every thought captive. Submit them to him. Let him show you his ways, and by him showing you his ways, that will correct your thoughts. Psalm 10:17, Lord, you have heard the desire of the humble. The desire of who? The humble. You will prepare their heart and you will cause their ear to hear. Someone who is not willing to listen to the word of God does not have a humble heart nor has an ear to hear. Psalm 145:19, he will fulfill the desire of them that fear him, that revere him. He will also hear their cry and will save them. Isaiah 26:8. Following the way of your judgments, we put our hope in you. The desire of, what's that say? All our soul. And with everything that is within us, our desire is to remember you and your name. In other words, to remember you and your character, you and your ways, you and your life. And then the next verse. My soul desires you at night. My spirit in me seeks you at dawn. Now listen to this. For when your judgments are here on earth, the people learn what righteousness is. What's the implication? That his judgments show us his righteousness. If we're not willing to take a look at his judgments, we're not going to see what he calls righteous. We often say, oh, I can do this, and it's okay. God knows my heart, and saying, okay, that's again, that's the selfish, that's me, that's all everything there again. When are we going to learn his heart? It's not about my heart, it's about his. So when are we going to stop saying God knows my heart and to say, no, my desire is to have his heart in here? That's where we need to change. Deuteronomy 30:15. See, I have set before you this day life and good and death and evil. 16. And that I command you this day to do what? Love the Lord your God. Can you imagine? I command you this day to love the Lord your God. Well, I'm not going to do it. Who does he think he is to tell me what to do? Well, yeah, kind of like we said earlier, you ever notice, it'll be okay, you can do whatever you want to do, but the minute somebody says, this is what I want you to do, we don't want to do it. Right? kind of like we say, you know, okay, I'm going to pick a day, just pick one day out of the year, and I'm going to make it, that's my day every year, I'm going to pray and fast just that day. And nobody will say anything to you. I mean, nobody will say anything to you. They won't care. But the minute you say, hey guys, you know, Yom Kippur's coming up, we should fast that day.
Well.
Why? Because God said he wanted us to do it? Huh. Think about it. That's the rebellion in us. Right? So what does it say? I command you this day to love the Lord your God. So what does it mean to love the Lord your God? Well, Yeshua said in John chapter 14 and chapter 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Right? So again, we come back to here. What does he say? To love the Lord your God. What now does it say next? Walk in his ways, keep his commandments, his statutes, and his judgments, that you may live and multiply. Let's paraphrase that. That you may have life and have it more abundantly. Where have you heard that? John 10:10. Yeshua said, I have come that they may have life and have it. Yep. And then he says, and the Lord your God shall bless you in the land wherever you go to possess it. Verse 17. But if your heart faces away in disobedience, so as not to hear. You ever notice that? You get like a kid. They do two things. You know, the little kids, they're either going to stand there like this, la, 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 right? Or when you talk to them, they're doing this. You know, it's like, if I don't look at you, that means I'm not listening. You know, it's like, that's when you grab their little cheeks and you say, nope, you're going to look at me. Because that's the idea. If we turn our face away, we're not listening. That's what God said. If we turn our face away from him and walk away, we're not listening to what he said. You know, same thing. So if your heart faces away in disobedience so as not to hear, but your desires mislead you. Wait. But God knows my heart. What's it say, Cheryl? But God knows my heart. No, your desires mislead you. That's why we read in Numbers when it says in the whole area, it talks about the tzitzit, or it says, you are to do this as a reminder that you are to keep my ways and not following your heart's desires. Because the heart is a deceitful and wicked thing. Right? So your desires mislead you, drawing you away, pushing off the word and teachings of Yahweh. I denounce to you this day, you shall surely perish, and that you shall not prolong your days upon the land where you go to possess it, in the Jordan to go to possess it. Very simple. God says, I have these blessings for you if you just listen to me. If you choose not to listen to me, you're not going to get these blessings. Outside of these blessings are curses. Simple. You choose. You have that choice. Verse 19. I call heaven and earth to record this day against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. Why? That both you and your seed may live. I call who? Two witnesses. Heaven and earth. As long as the witnesses stand, what they were called to stand witness to stands. What did they stand witness to? I call this day, heaven and earth, to be witnesses that I have told you the life and death, blessings and cursings. I have set before you the covenant of God. Choose. Heaven and earth themselves are witnesses for what was put in front of you. I think they're still witnesses. What do you think? I mean, they're still here, right? Verse 20. What are we supposed to do then? To love the Lord your God. Have you noticed that common thread through these couple chapters? To love the Lord your God. So how do we do that? To love the Lord your God. To hearken to his voice. Cleave to him. That is your life and your length of days. That you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob to give to them. How do we dwell in the promise? How do we live in the promise? How do we stand in what the Father is giving us? Very simple. Listen to him. Hearken to his voice. that hearken to his voice means very simple, obey him. Do what he said. And cling to him. Not cling to these other things of life. Not cling to the other idols. Not cling to even our own desires. Cling to him. And we will have everything that he promised us. And to walk in the blessings he has established for us. Amen? Amen. Let's all stand.
Well, if this teaching has blessed you, I want you to check out our other resources. You can check out our website at www.ruachonline.com. And there's links there to other resources that are available to you, other teachings, other books, other offerings. You can go to YouTube, Facebook, all of these things from our website. And check us out, because if they enjoyed this teaching, there's going to be much more that hopefully will bless you as well. Thank you. Hi, this is Dr. David Jones from Ruach Ministries International, and I've got some exciting news for you. We have a new series coming out, 6-part series of the Gospel According to Abraham. Abraham? What does he got to do with the gospel? Well, you're going to have to find out, aren't you? The thing is, Galatians 3 says that the gospel was proclaimed to Abraham. So what does that mean for a believer today? What does that mean to a person who is not Jewish? What does that mean to a person who is Jewish? What does that mean for all of us today? Well, check it out. It's a good series, and it'll be coming your way soon. For more information, you can check out our website at www.ruachonline.com. Hi, this is Dr. David Jones here. I just want to say we do have some other resources available to you, one of which is a book entitled Famine, Walking and Blessing in the Time of Famine. It's based out of Amos 8, 11 and 12, talking about there's a famine of hearing the word of the Lord. So what is that famine? Does it mean the word of the Lord is not being proclaimed, or does it mean there's a famine of actually listening to it? Food for thought, isn't it? Well, if you want to know more, check it out. Go to www.ruachonline.com, and there's a link on our homepage. Just click and it'll take you for more information on the book entitled Famine, Walking and Blessing in a Time of Famine. Well, how important are the feasts of the Lord? I think we can say that if the Lord set out a banquet, set out a table, and invited you to come be a partaker, would we answer? Would we hear? Would we go? Or would we blow him off because we have something more important to do? Well, that's what this book is. The King invites you to his table. Are we going to answer the call? The Feast of the Lord, appointed times where the Lord has said he wants to meet with us face to face. Will we heed? Will we answer? Will we go? Check it out, www.ruachonline.com. On the homepage, there is a link to take you for more information. The King invites you to his table.